Hi, and welcome to my talk, Iteration in Perl. This is by me, Abram Hindle, and I'm currently an assistant professor of computing science at the University of Alberta. This talk is not completely idiomatic. So, iteration is a fundamental building block of most programming languages, and it makes programming useful because we can get computers to repeat tasks. We can get them to iterate over data, or iterate over numbers and spaces, and calculate results for us. Iteration usually refers to repetition. In mathematics, iterating function usually means that we're applying it repeatedly. In programming, iteration can refer to any method of repetition, usually loops. So for the rest of the talk, I'm going to rely on some concepts. One is a block. A block is a chunk of code, and in Perl, usually a block is something that's surrounded by curly braces. It's usually the part of the code that gets repeated, and it usually follows lexical scope rules, assuming you're strict. A condition is an expression that evaluates a true or false. It's commonly used to determine if a loop continues. Other concepts we use are strictness. Basically, if it's strict, everything gets done and executed. If it's lazy, things only get done or executed when they're needed. If something is executed in order, it's executed in a sequence in sequential order. If it's executed out of order, it means that things can be executed in any order whatsoever. They might not be order dependent. Dependency means that one value depends on another. Oftentimes this is, say, like a variable that's the loop body depends on. So here we go. We've got while loops. These are one of the first ways to repeat in Perl. So basically they allow us to repeat a block until a condition is met, and usually that loop invariant, this condition here, executes first. So if we look at this very simple while loop, I got condition equals 1, and it says while condition is true, execute this code, and here it negates condition, so condition will be set to false or undef or something like that. We can also use while loops when we don't know how many things exist, like say file IO, like lines. So here we're reading from standard in, and we're just counting how many lines we get. We won't know until we're done typing and send it in. We can also use while loops on numbers. So here we go, my x equals 10, and while x is greater than 0, decrement x. What's interesting here, and in this one, is that the condition of the while loop and the body of the while loop both depend on a variable. So in this case, x is dependent in the condition and in the body, and it's dependent on this x. It's dependent on this x right here. For here, the condition, the body is dependent on the condition variable. Again, here, x is dependent on, the body is dependent on this x, and the condition is dependent on x. Another use for while loops is basically to see how to define a stopping condition and to loop and iterate. Sometimes you don't know how long it's going to take. And, well, maybe math's not your strong suit. So you can use the while loop to basically keep doing something until you know you should stop. So in this case, it's going to keep dividing x by 3 until x is less than or equal to 1. Another way to loop in Perl is the for loop. A for loop allows us to iterate with a condition or over a list of collection elements. So the for loop over elements, here we've got for my dollar I and 1 to 9, so I will be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, and then we add it to the sum here. We calculate the sum. This loop body is dependent on sum and I, but I doesn't escape, so it's not a big deal. We can also use C-style for loops, where we have an initialization step here, I equals 1, we have a condition here, and then we have a incrementer here where it modifies I. I is the body, and all of these things, the incrementer and dependency, all depend upon I, but they also depend upon sum. The value of sum is needed in every single loop because the value of sum is needed for this plus equals part. This is a similar loop, but we do it with strings, just trying to emphasize we don't have to do everything with numbers. So this will concatenate, and it goes for each element in ABC, append it to S, and S will be ABC at the end. So for loops are good for iterating over a set of elements that you know they have a set size, or doing C-style loops where you have an initial value and then a final value. Another way to do iteration is recursion. Recursion is relatively complicated for most, but it allows arbitrary flow control, and it's good for iterating data structures like trees. The problem with recursion is oftentimes there's stack overflows because you go too deep into the stack. So here's an example of recursive iteration. We first have a condition. This condition is that there's elements in the arguments. That there's more than, there's one or more elements in the argument. So this will return false if there's zero arguments left. So what we do is we pop one off the head of that, we take that value, and we add it to our recursive sum. So this has been modified, and it is sent in there. Then, through recursion, it will be 1 plus 2 plus 3 plus 4 until we get to 10. And then finally, when there's nothing left, it'll just add 0 at the end, because 0 will be the return result. You can also do this in a reverse order with tail recursion. Recursion is really good for hashes and tree-like structures. Another kind of iteration is O iteration. So an example is to use an iterator. So oftentimes an iterator is basically a class that, an instance of a class that has a next method and a hasNext method, or something along those lines. So here we have hasNext. hasNext basically checks to see if our index into a list is less than the size of the list. If it is, then we're still good to go. If it's not, then we're done. We'll return false. The next method mutates this object, and it gets the value out of the sequence that we threw in, because see here, we feed it a sequence right here. But it gets a value out, and then it increments by 2, and then it returns. Why are we incrementing by 2? Well, because we called this iterator only even, so we only want even indexed elements out of the list. So we give it a list, and it will only give us the even ones. The way we iterate through this is with a while loop, because maybe we're not sure how many times this will run, so the while loop will keep running this condition hasNext till it is false. This will print 1, 3, 5, 7, and 9. Those are the even indexed values. They're not the even values, but they're the even indexed values. So this is an OO kind of interface, and the benefit of OO iteration is you have a lot of control, and you can change the flow control at any time, and you can also delegate and do crazy stuff. So OO iteration is pretty powerful, and it goes even beyond iterators. All right, I want you to think about something. Everything we showed was iterated in order. For instance, in here, we went from 0, and we incremented by 2 every time. Every increment depended on the prior value of index, and it depended on the value of sequence. If we look at this, it was done in order from the first element that was shifted out to the last element. But technically, a sum doesn't have to be that way. We could have done it in reverse order. In all of these, we've defined the order as this value to this value, or this value to this value, or from this to this, and we've specified the order here. If the order doesn't work out here, we wouldn't get ABC. But in this case, the order doesn't matter. We could do this sum in any order. Alright, so you got to consider if order doesn't matter. Remember, we can do a sum in any order. Any part of the sum can be done out of order, and it'll still come up with the same results. This starts relating into the map function. In mathematics, iterating function means applying it repeatedly. Applying a map function applies one function to all the elements in the collection and produces a new collection of the application of that function, the results of that function. Usually this is in order, so the results are in order, but you don't have to do the execution in order. What it looks like is if we take like a function f and we apply it to ABC, we'll get a list of the application of f to a, f to b, f to c. So a more concrete example, imagine we're doing map of the square. Square is our function. And we'll do 1, 2, 3. So that means the result will be 1 squared, 2 squared, and 3 squared. So we'll produce a new collection based on the old collection we gave it by applying that function to it. and the return will be in order. But it doesn't have to be. Square, in this case, doesn't care about this value if it's getting the square of 3. So it doesn't have to be in order. So in Perl, map is built right in, which is very nice. So here we've got a list V of 1 to 30. We add 1 to the list. Now our list U will be 2, 3, 4 to 31. So it produces a new list. It doesn't mutate V. This new list is the prior list incremented by 1 for every element. We can apply various other functions. So on map, we give it a block. So we go map, base name, the value. Notice the value comes in as dollar underscore. And we go give us the base name of home file user local. So it'll give us the base name. We can also apply map in a different way by giving a reference to the function directly instead of giving it a block. But you got to remember, you got to know the name here. So here I'm giving it uppercase the V, and it'll map those strings to home file user local, all capitalized. But you need to know the name of the function. This is oftentimes useful when you say have a bunch of tasks to do, like get these web pages, and then you say, well, get these web pages in order, get the HTML out of those pages. So we can do something like this. Unfortunately, this one takes a while. What's also interesting is it doesn't matter what order I get these in, right? If you want all three of those gotten, then we have to get all three of them, but does it matter if we do GCCA over CBC.ca? So consider that. Because that order might not matter, we can actually exploit parallelism. That is, we can cut up the work, and we can split off onto, say, multiple processors, multiple threads, or multiple processes. So parallel map is a nice module you can get from CPAN, and it implements map in parallel according to how many cores you have. So here we've got the square function, the first value times the first value. And what we're doing is we're squaring this very large list, and then eventually we're printing out how big it is. So what will happen is we'll make a list of the squares of these values, and that will be U. So we'll take these values and we'll map them into U. So we'll get the squares. And the size should be about that. A good candidate for the parallel map is IO. So here we're doing get, LWP simple get, and we're getting all these URLs, but we can get them in parallel. And the URLs are independent of each other, so they shouldn't really matter. So each block is independent. What's nice is if you look here, there's only one value that matters. There's no reference to any other values, like U or anything like that. These blocks are independent. They don't have any external values, and they can operate on the arguments coming in without modifying the global state. Another kind of method of iteration is reduce. Instead of producing another list, maybe we want to collapse the collection down into a single value via the application of a function. So you can imagine if we had 100 elements, we could go, we could say apply f of the first element, apply f to the first element, and then f to the second element. So if we go all the way back, we'd go f of E99 versus f of E100 applied to dot 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 dot. So it's basically applying functions to a two-argument function in order, in a row. And we can actually do a summation with this by using an add function. So we can go add E99 to E100, and then add E98 to this result, and then add E97 to that result, and then add da, 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 E4 to all that result, and add E2 to all that result, and add E1 to all result, and you got a sum. Basically, sum is a reduce. Luckily, list util provides us with reduce and sum. Here we can get the sum. Notice how it uses the sort semantics, with $A and $B being set as the two arguments. We can also just call sum. Both of these return the same values. Reduce can be parallel if the dependencies work out, and if you can, if you gain from commutative and associative properties of the task. So summation is associative and commutative. So we can do it in different orders. So here I've got a split list method that uses part from list U more utils, and it splits the list into n lists. So if we have a list of 3,000, I tell it to split into lists of 3, it'll produce 3 lists of 1,000 apiece. Then we've got a parallel square, that is just a parallel map of a square function. And then we have parallel sum, which is, it splits a list in the 4 different lists, and then it applies a parallel map to it, and it gets the sum of each of the 4 parts of the initial arguments, and then it sums those 4 parts together. So this final sum is only 4 elements. These sums could be hundreds of elements. So then if we want to do the parallel square and the parallel sum, we can do this, and we thus have a parallel map reduce. We're reducing in the parallel sum, and we got a parallel map here in the square. This works because there's basically a tree structure to our problem. Problems that have commutative or associative parts can oftentimes be modeled as a tree of computation. So you can imagine we have the task of sum, and we can break down sum into multiple sub-summations, all the way down to just adding 2 together. But we could just break it down to that level. This allows us to do sums on different parts of the list, and we can do those independently, and we can do them in parallel. So we can gain that. We can reduce dependencies on our little work blocks by avoiding initialization. We don't need to care that we could initialize sum to 0. Really, that initialization is not needed because we can actually just set sum to be the sum of the results of the summations of the partitions. So we actually don't need to initialize sum. By avoiding initialization of sum, we make the blocks, like these pluses, to be independent of each other, and they don't need to share this information. So I want you to think about whether or not you need in-order operation, or whether or not you need dependency or initialized values, whether or not you need to share this stuff around. Because if you don't, you can then apply map and reduce. Map and reduce are good if you want to parallelize blocks. Any kind of parallelization gains from reduced dependencies. Oops, I meant Perl, sorry. So the main forms of iteration in Perl, not Python, I have a Python talk, are for, while, iterators, recursion, map, and reduce. We want to reduce the dependencies because then we can use map and reduce, and then we can do parallelism. If we don't need to do things in order, then maybe we don't have to do them that way. Maybe we can make gains from parallelism. These concepts also apply to other languages. For instance, I actually gave a Python talk that's pretty well the same thing, except uses slightly different modules. The talk doesn't look that much different, quite frankly. The point is if you can think in this map and reduce paradigm, you can make your problems easily parallelizable, whether on the same machine or even spawning out to multiple machines. All right, thank you for your time.